3x plus 1/5 y equals 7. Spoiler alert, most of these, we're going to do this thing first. We're going to add or subtract. Okay, do cancel out. I don't really like that term. The thing that's being added or subtracted to the term we want to isolate. Okay, so we're usually going to add or subtract something to start with and to probably divide slash multiply by the reciprocal, which is just the same thing as dividing if the thing you're dividing by is a fraction. So if it comes to dividing and it turns out we have a fraction to divide by, we'll multiply by the reciprocal. Right? It's just, man, it's been so many times that we have subtracted something from both sides and then divided, or added something to both sides and then divided, or subtracted from both sides and multiplied by the reciprocal. It's a very familiar two steps, right? So, with the mission in mind that we're trying to get y by itself, what can we do first? Colby?
Subtract by 7, and then y, 7.
No. Subtract by what?
Y.
Subtract y? Subtracting y is not going to do much for us, because there's no, see, think about it, that we're going to subtract to cancel out adding, right? Is y being added? No. Well, y is not being added, 1/5 of y is being added. Okay? You could subtract 1/5 y. I'm going to go ahead and recommend that you don't subtract 1/5 y. Hunter, what do you think?
Subtract
3x from 3x and 3x from 7. So 3x minus 3x, why have we done this? Because 3x minus 3x is what?
Zero.
0x, right? And we have nothing here. We just have, on this side, 1/5 y. And on this side, we have what?
7 minus
3x. 7 minus 3x. Right, there's the subtract. Let me show you a really similar thing, but more like a more basic equation. 5y plus 2 equals 12, okay? 5y plus 2 equals 12, where we would subtract 2, 5y equals 10, we would divide by 5, and y equals 2. It's just, algebra student has solved an equation by doing those last two steps the exact same every time. Subtract, the thing that's being added. Divide, the thing that's being multiplied. So what do we do now? We need for y to be, instead of 1/5 y, to be 1 times y.
Can we divide by 1/5?
We can divide by 1/5. Okay. I don't really like dividing by fractions, right? So how can I divide by a fraction a little more easily? And divide by a fraction is the same as what? Doing what?
Reciprocal.
What about the reciprocal? Okay, review time, which we'll just color blue to remind us we're in review time. If I want to divide by a fraction, let's say I take 2 and I divide it by the fraction 3/5. In the end, it'll be the same as 2 over 1 times 5 over 3, multiplying by the reciprocal. Let me prove it. I'll multiply by 5/3 in the denominator, in the numerator. Okay. Let me rewrite that just a little bit. I'll multiply the denominator by 5/3 and the numerator by 5/3. Okay. I'm just multiplying this fraction by this fraction. What's this equal to? This is the fraction 5/3 divided by 5/3. What is that equal to? 1. Something divided by itself is 1. So I'm just multiplying this by 1. No big deal. So in the numerator, we get 2 over 1 times 5 over 3. What's in the denominator? multiplying straight across, the denominators get multiplied by each other, we get 15 over 15. Which is 1. We're dividing 2 over 1 times 5 over 3. We're dividing that by 1, which is just the same as 2 over 1 times 5 over 3, so 10 thirds. So dividing by the fraction is the same as multiplying by?
The
reciprocal that you're dividing by. Same as multiplying by the reciprocal thing you're dividing by. So we're dividing by 1/5, so we'll multiply by the reciprocal of 1/5.
5/1.
5/1 times 5/1. You're going to multiply this side by 5/1, which we'll just do 5. So we get y equals 5 times 7 minus 3x. And y is by itself and perfectly fine. You can make the side look a little bit different by distributing the 5 and getting 35 minus 15x. But either way is correct because they're both equivalent to each other. Question, Hunter? Equals 7x minus 2y. Okay, we're solving for y again, getting y by itself. Pattern here, Hallie, first you're going to do what?
Subtract
7x. Look at this, it's a negative 2y and it's a plus 7x. So we'll get 0x here. And so on the left side we have pi minus 7x. Equals negative 2y. Must be muscle memory or just a reflex to do this. Brandon?
Plus x, or 7x, right?
We just subtracted 7x so that we would get this more by itself. If we add 7x to both sides, this would be less by itself.
Subtract pi then?
If we subtract pi, we'd have to subtract pi from this side, and it would be less by itself. Tyler?
Divide 2 by 2y.
Divide by 2y?
Negative 2y.
If I divide negative 2y, divide by negative 2y, well?
I multiply negative 2.
Yeah, what's something divided by itself?
0. 1.
I hope we hear less, but fewer zeros as time moves on. When we divide a number by itself, we always get 1. So this is 1. Did I want to get 1 on this side?
No.
No,
I want to get just y by itself. Y. 1 times y, not 0.
So
I don't want 0 y.
Just negative 2.
So just negative 2. Because the negative 2 divided by negative 2 is 1, and that's good. But that leaves y on this side. Divide by negative 2, pi minus 7x over negative 2. And we have 1y on the other side. So y equals pi minus 7x divided by negative 2. Notice again that structure of subtract 7x, subtract something from both sides. What does that leave? It leaves y times something if we divide by that thing. Let's go back to this one. Look at this simpler example I gave to you earlier. 5y plus 2 equals 12 minus 2, right? Subtract and then divide. Let's look at this one. Subtract 3x from both sides and then essentially divide by 1/5 or multiply by 5. Subtract the thing that's being added to your variable, and then select coefficient. So whether you divide by 1/5, multiply by 5, that's the same thing. And again, subtract 7x from both sides, subtract. Right? First thing we did was subtract, and then 2, we divide. Subtract and divide. Subtract and divide. Now the subtracting might be the subtracting of a negative, which actually is addition, so we might add something to both sides. Okay? And then dividing might look more like multiplying by the reciprocal, but it's all the same. Stop distracting me. Let Brandon learn.
Allie.
17. Allie. Oh, Allie. 17. As we were at school or something. And we were about to go to lunch. Talking about whatever we wanted to. So, I think it helps just sort of at the beginning level here to just point out, since we're looking to get L by itself, 2 times L times W is the same as 2 times W times L, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You don't have to rewrite it that way. Like, you can do this whole thing without having rewritten that, but it may help you. Notice we have the L, the thing we would isolate. It's multiplied by a thing and something's being added to it. Right? Multiplied by a thing, having something added to it. Let's go back and we see something multiplied by our variable, something added to it, something multiplied by our variable and added to it, something multiplied by our variable and added to it. Okay, very similar structure here. Hunter?
So don't you run 1, 2, pi, w.
Number is 1/2.
And then you minus that by 8. Hold on for a second.
We're going to subtract 1/2 pi w squared. We're going to subtract 1/2 pi w squared. We're going to add that from both sides. So we have a minus 1/2 pi w squared equals 2 w.
Divide by
2 by 2WL? We want to leave L, don't we? We don't want to cancel L out. We want to divide by just 2W. Divide by 2W. A minus 1/2 pi W squared divided by 2W. So the same thing. We subtracted from both sides and we divided. The thing we subtracted is ugly, but we subtracted it. The thing we divided, also kind of ugly, but we divided by it. Same thing. If there's something added to our variable, we'll subtract and cancel it out. If there's something multiplied by our variable, we'll divide, cancel that out. Brandon?
Wouldn't it be 1W though? Because 2 divided by 2 is 1, and it's 2W, so it would be 1W.
Are you talking about like here?
No, right.
Right?
Yeah.
2W divided by 2W. 2 divided by 2 is 1.
Right.
W divided by W is 1. We have a 1 times 1. And a 1 times 1, you have 1L over 1. Let's see, let's take 2WL, divided by 2W. I'm going to rewrite it as 2 over 2 times W over W times L over 1. If I were to multiply these three fractions together, how would I multiply fractions together?
Straight across.
So we multiply fractions, we multiply straight across. Okay. So if we multiply these two together, we get 2 times W. If we take that and multiply that by L, so we get 2 times W times L. Right? Okay. And then in the denominator, we get 2 times W times the same 1. The 2 times W times 1 gives us 2W down here. Okay. So all I'm establishing here is that these two things, either the multiplication of these three fractions, these are the same. Okay. These are the same. And 2 divided by 2 is 1, and W divided by W is 1, and so we have 1 times 1 times L over 1, and so we just have L over. So just kind of proving that the 2W, L divided by 2W is the L. Next, 21. formula here. They tell us that what it does is it, first you have to write it correctly, and then it'll work correctly. 5/9 times f minus 32. It runs it, and then we add 273.15. Okay, so this equation, this formula, you can plug something in for f, which is degrees Fahrenheit, which is the temperature scale we use in America, right? So you might, like, what's 32? 32 is how cold?
Freezing.
Freezing. Water freezes at around 32 degrees, okay? Whereas Celsius,
zero.
Don't need any beatboxing.
Right.
Zero beatboxing, just in case everybody was wondering. Where does water freeze on the Celsius scale hold?
Zero
Celsius. So zero Celsius, 32 Fahrenheit. Okay. And Kelvin is a different measuring, you know, temperature measuring scale. It's not measured in degrees. You don't say degrees Kelvin. You just say Kelvin, just some number Kelvin. Okay. And zero Kelvin is where everything, all molecules in an object stop moving. Absolutely stop moving. It's called absolute zero. Okay. The thing, what makes something hot is that its molecules are moving quickly. What makes something cold is that its molecules are moving slowly. What makes something absolutely cold at absolute zero is that its molecules have stopped moving altogether. Okay. You might not realize it. Molecules are moving around quite a bit. And whatever, if you pick anything out of this room, the molecules in this thing are moving pretty quickly. And if you get it to stop, so far has proven impossible, nobody's done it, nobody's gotten anything to absolute zero, they've gotten very close, but not absolute zero. If anything's gonna happen near absolute zero, they can slow light from thousands of miles per second to, I think, single digits of miles per hour. They can slow light down really, really slowly at low temperatures. But what we're gonna do is turn this equation, rather one that turns degrees Fahrenheit into Kelvin, turns Kelvin to degrees Fahrenheit, don't you?
If you got it to like zero Kelvin, could it make like light not travel? Would it stop?
Seems like it.
So zero Kelvin.
I'm not a big scientist about this. I just know what I hear on NPR. Yeah?
We're
solving it. Okay, right, go for
so
it.
So 9/5.
What about 9/5?
Divided by itself.
To multiply by 9/5?
Yeah.
Okay, good idea. If I multiply this by 9/5, though, like say I multiply this by 9/5, so I multiply the entire left side by 9/5, which means I have to multiply by 9/5. I have to multiply everything by 9/5. And I could, I don't really feel like multiplying this by 9/5. How about if I get rid of that first, and then we'll multiply by 9/5? See what I'm saying? So if we multiply by 9/5 right now, I have to multiply this by 9/5 because I have to multiply both sides by 9/5. Doing the same thing to both sides. So rather than that, right now, let's, because of that issue, let's just get rid of that 273.15.
So subtract it.
Subtract it. 273.15. Subtract 273.15. K minus 273.15 equals 5/9 times F minus 32. Now, if I multiply this side by 9/5, that's it, just 9/5 times 5/9, there's nothing to distribute it to over here anymore. Okay. This is all multiplication, multiply. So you just multiply these two guys together. What happens if you multiply 9/5 by 5/9?
A
1, very good, very good. And we multiply this side by 9/5. Multiply the left side by 9/5, we need to just put the whole thing in parentheses and multiply by 9/5. So we have 9/5 k minus 273, parentheses, 273.15 equals f minus 32. We're almost there.
Add 32.
So we have 9/5 times k minus 273. Once we do all of that, we'll add 32 subtracted this 273.15 from both sides. Then we had 5/9 times f minus 32 multiplied by the reciprocal. Cancel that out. Then we're just left with f minus 32. To cancel out this minus 32, we'll add 32. 9/5 times parentheses plus 32. So that's part A. We solved it. We got f by itself. Now they ask us in part B. In part B, the freezing point of water in Kelvin is 273.15. What's the freezing point in Fahrenheit? We already talked about what the freezing point in Fahrenheit is. What is it?
32.
So our answer had better come out to be 32.
Yep.
When we plug in the freezing point in Kelvin, let's look at it, it says 273.15. Look at that, it's exactly the same thing as what we're subtracting here.
How Kelvin was zero, though?
32. What's that?
How Kelvin was zero, though?
It's Kelvin.
Kelvin.
And zero Kelvin is not just the freezing point of water, it is the stopping of all molecules in an object.
So if it was like...
When water's frozen, the molecules are still moving around. They're just not moving around very much. They're just kind of really close, and maybe they're not zooming from place to place, but they're vibrating next to each other. They're still moving. At absolute zero, they would just stop. They wouldn't move at all, which is really hard to get a molecule to do. Well, just the surrounding temperature is affecting molecules. We're not even sure if it's possible to stop molecules completely from just even vibrating. So 273.15 minus 273.15 is?
Zero.
And 0 times 9/5 is?
9/5.
0 times?
0.
Oh. 0. Anything times 0 is 0. So we're just left with 32. So 32 degrees Fahrenheit. That's how many degrees Fahrenheit water freezes. It freezes at 273.15. Okay. So the freezing point of water, which is pretty cold to us humans, is really high on the Kelvin scale, which tells you that things that are low in the numbers of Kelvin, are really, really cold to us. Yes?
Oh, I was going to say the answer for C. I'm
going to say the answer for C. That was on the front page. How do we find it? How do we find the answer? Nope. We've got to compare. Okay, so here's the question. Part C says, the temperature of dry ice is negative 78.5 degrees C, which if you're paying attention, like I wasn't last period, this is in Celsius, right?
Yeah.
It's not in Kelvin, it's not in Fahrenheit, the temperature scales we've been talking about this entire time, right? This is dry ice. This is dry ice.
Oh.
And at 77.35 Kelvin, notice no degrees, just Kelvin. That's where liquid nitrogen, liquid nitrogen, that's where it lives on the Kelvin scale. It's hard to compare Celsius and Kelvin, they're on different scales. We need to compare them to each other. Is Celsius to Celsius, Kelvin to Kelvin, or Fahrenheit to Fahrenheit, okay? Well, we have a way to take this Kelvin and turn it into Fahrenheit. If you look back in the examples from the lesson in the book, they also give us this, that F equals 9/5 C plus 32. So here's a formula for changing Celsius into Fahrenheit. Here's a formula for turning Kelvin into Fahrenheit. So we'll take each of those temperatures, put them in Fahrenheit, and then we'll be able to compare them. So we have a Celsius temperature here. We'll throw it in to this guy here. 9/5 times negative 78.5 degrees plus 32. Just plug negative 78.5 in for C. Let us see out of parentheses. one-fifths times negative 78.5.
Negative 109.3.
We'll take this Kelvin and we'll convert it into Fahrenheit using this guy right here. So 9/5 times 77.35 minus 273.15 plus 32. That'll give us the temperature in Fahrenheit. So. If I was the kind of person who complained about being confused, I would think the strategy of giggling at my friends, I don't know, this doesn't seem like the best way to be less confused, to be more proficient. Negative 320.44. Okay, so what's colder, negative 320.44 degrees Fahrenheit or negative 109.3 degrees Fahrenheit? Yeah?
It would be Fahrenheit?
These are both in Fahrenheit.
109.
Negative 109 colon? It's negative.
Oh, negative 3.
Yeah, negative 320, that's like three times as cold. Almost.
I thought we were talking about flight.
It's, yeah, just about three times as cold as this. What balloon was this? Was this liquid nitrogen or was this dry ice? This is liquid nitrogen, it's quite cold. Liquid nitrogen is the winner in the contest of which is colder. If you touch it, definitely your skin would burn if you didn't just freeze altogether. Have you ever seen stuff like, you know, watermelons or apples or roses or shoes?
Put a
cheeto
in it.
Who? You did?
Yeah.
Oh, you put a cheeto in liquid nitrogen and you ate it? Hey, that's cool.
You
would
probably guess.
Okay. If you put something in liquid nitrogen, generally it'll become so frozen, the molecules will slow down so much, it'll become very much solid and crystalline in nature, and you can smash it with a hammer and break it into lots of pieces.
Bill Nye.
A friend of mine worked at a plant where they had liquid nitrogen in a big tank, and one day, just talking up here, he came. And so there's a night crew and there's a day crew, and the day crew came and there was just this gross, disgusting stuff on the sidewalk outside. They didn't know what it was. Turns out the night crew got a little bored and they were dipping rats in the liquid nitrogen, throwing them off the roof and watching them shatter.
That's disgusting.
Thought out.
Dude, that's awesome.
You are.
I would do that.
You killed rats.
I mean,
oh my god.
Let's clear our desks.
I would call it that.
Subtract 6x. Subtract 6x from both sides. Please stop talking except for Brandon.
It would be 3y equals 9, and then, or 9, yeah, 9.
Just 9?
No, 9 minus 6x. And you divide by 3, negative 3y.
Divide by a y here, I would cancel this y, I would have no more y.
Oh, gosh.
Divide by negative 3,
yes.
So we get y
two.
Equals 9 minus 6x over negative 3.
Oh, I
put
3.
I put a y on the 3. I put just
back.
3, not negative.
I solve for 2.
Sure, number 2, Mac's going to solve 2 for us.
Okay, so you would
plus
4x. Plus
4x. Hunter, turn around, please. 2y equals 5r plus 4x.
And you would divide 2.
Divide by 2.
Both sides. So
divide
then
it all
y equals 5r plus 4x plus 5.
Congratulations. Very good. If you like this one, it can be written as 9 divided by negative 3. Plus negative 6 divided by negative 3 times x. 9 divided by negative 3 is negative 3. Negative 6 divided by negative 3 is positive 2. So negative 3 plus 2x. But if you have this as your answer, that's correct. If this is your answer, that's also correct. Negative 3 there. You could also write this as five halves are, plus 4 divided by 2 is 2, so 2x. 5 halves are plus 2x is also 2x. Does that, and you have your reviews. I recommend you do those as practice, especially since most of you did not do your homework. You really, really, really need to practice. So you should practice using this.
We still on our homework. Just turn in.
Yeah, turn in late work. It's not penalized.